Yes, sir. Welcome to What's Up Wednesday. My name is Craig McKay, your host, and thank you for joining us. I hope everyone had a great Thanksgiving weekend. Our guest today has 37 years of military experience leading and mentoring multifaceted teams in the US and Canada. He has recently published a book emanating from his military career entitled Developing Coaching Leaders. This is a very timely topic and a timely book, in my opinion, because I look around and I wonder, what does leadership mean in today's world? If leaders are supposed to set an example to bring about positive changes in the world, where are those positive changes today? If we want a better future, if we want to build organizations where people want to work, if we want to build nations where people want to live, if we want to build a world where we can all live in peace and prosperity, we need to develop leaders who have the skill sets to be effective in achieving these goals, in creating a vision or taking a vision and putting it into action. Our guest speaker today is doing his part in developing leaders and doing it under very stressful situations, as we will soon find out. He's joining us from his home in Cobourg, Ontario. And I'd like to begin by acknowledging the Indigenous people of those lands. Located in the traditional and treaty territory of the Miji-Sagig and Chippewa Nations, collectively known as the Williams Treaties First Nations, which include Curve Lake, Hiawatha, Alderville, Scugog Island, Rama, Beausoleil, and Georgina Island First Nations. We respectfully acknowledge that the Williams Treaties First Nations have been stewards and caretakers of these lands and waters along the St. Lawrence River, and that they remain vigilant over their health and integrity for generations to come. Hopefully, you can all get out to enjoy this great fall weather we are having and to see the beautiful colors up in the hills and the valleys. I mean, time sure does fly at this time of year. I can't believe it. Next month will be November, and on November the 8th, our What's Up Wednesday show will feature guest speaker Kristen Wan. The topic will be artificial intelligence and data analysis. The presentation will provide an overview of opportunities and challenges related to data analytics and AI in public sector organizations. Jennifer Smith will be sitting in for me as the guest host in November. So put that in your day timers. Thank you all for joining us today. What's Up Wednesday is brought to you by CMC Ontario in conjunction with CMC Canada. The CMC designation can give you a competitive advantage. It is the world's only internationally recognized credential for management consultants. Membership can put you in touch with a vast network of experienced management consultants from all walks of life with different areas of expertise. Today's show is being recorded. We have an archive of past shows available on the CMC Canada YouTube channel. As usual, we ask you to remain on mute. You can send in questions to the speaker via the chat tool. There will be a Q&A session at the end of the show in about 30 to 40 minutes from now. And we will also, by the way, have a couple of books to give away at the end of the show based on your chat answers to some questions that will come up during our speaker's presentation. He is the author of the book Developing Coaching Leaders, Major General Scott Clancy, now retired. Scott served in multiple squadrons of the Royal Canadian Air Force as a tactical helicopter pilot. As a director general in the RCAF, his responsibilities included all personnel, operations, logistics, infrastructure, as well as strategic planning. In his last years of service, he was the deputy commander of the Alaskan NORAD region and director of operations for all NORAD in Colorado Springs. He attended the Collège Militaire Royal de Saint-Jean and was apparently a pretty good basketball player from what I've heard. As the head of operations and subsequent chief of staff for one wing in the RCAF, Scott was given the responsibility to plan and deploy helicopter forces in the war in Afghanistan, for which he earned a Meritorious Service Medal. He earned a second HSM for leading the air component responding in the aftermath of the tragic earthquake in Haiti in 2010. Wow. Since retirement, Scott served as a senior mentor on courses developed for senior officers of the RCAF, and he is a fellow of the Canadian Global Affairs Institute. You may have seen him quite recently on CNN Morning or CBC News or CTV News. Today, we are pleased to have Scott Clancy here to talk about developing coaching leaders. Welcome, Scott, and thanks for joining us.
Well, Craig, thank you very much for having me. It's an honor to be able to speak to this esteemed audience. And if we could go to the next slide, my background, largely military, that kind of military stuff. But as you can see on the slide, that's a picture of me when I was in Haiti commanding the air component in 2010, thrust into it on a few hours notice, and then had to lead a multidimensional team in two airfields, one in Port-au-Prince and one on the Southern Claw. So, I've got a lot of experience in operations, preparing forces for operations, but I was a coach in basketball. So it was a lot of the confluence of that coaching stuff that led to me wanting to talk more about leadership and what it was to lead. So, if you could go to the next slide, CMC asked me to come here and talk about leadership and coaching, motivational mentoring, pulling teams together, mastering the stress of dealing with less and less available qualified manpower and what you do in the current economy. And I thought that was a lot. So I might have picked and choose a few things that I thought were better in my wheelhouse. And as we walk through the presentation, I'll try to give you a sense of what I think is the essence of how to develop leaders that coach teams to excellence. That picture, if you see there, that's from my time in Alaska. That's the F-22 Rafter, two squadrons of F-22s, the airborne early warning system and the tankers that support them. Alaska being the largest state in the union. And if you stretch it from, it goes from California to Florida and Wisconsin to Texas. And if you cut it in half, Texas is still the third largest state. So it's the kind of space that we were defending with those forces up there. So what we want to do to start it off, however, if you go to the next slide, let's start this off on a bit of a fun note. Here's a question for all y'all to answer in the chat. And the best answer is going to get a free signed copy of my book, Developing Coaching Leaders. And the winners of this and the next giveaway are going to be announced by Craig just before the question period at the end. Okay, here's the question. What do you think is the number one thing that executives are seeking out professional coaching for? Okay, we're going to post that into the chat right now. And what we're going to do is move on to the next slide. We'll start talking about this. And Craig's going to have a look at those questions as we talk more in detail about leadership and coaching. So for our journey today, I'm going to outline six steps. What I think is the path of pulling teams together and sustaining inspired motivation and execution. Those six steps are: one, adding coaching skills; two, focusing on individual and team development; three, inspire, that's individual and team; four, communicate to connect. Okay, communicate to connect. Five, connect to translate and coach. And then six, give trust to get trust. All right. Those six steps, and we're not going to post them in now, we're going to do it to the end because we want you to listen to each one of the steps, right? They're based upon a few underpinning principles for me. And some of these underlying principles, I'm just going to outline two of them. Leadership and coaching, to me, are emotional trust relationships. Now, emotional trust relationship means that it's emotional, it's surrounds and it's based upon trust, but that it's a relationship like any other personal relationship that you have, whether with your family or friends or peers or consorts or anything like that. So leadership and coaching are emotional trust relationships. And that's kind of one of the underlying principles. Second one is that to really inspire, lead, and coach teams to their maximum success, leaders have to elevate the relationship that they have with those people on their teams above the binary transactional relationship that's just focused on performance. In other words, if the relationship is more important than whatever you're dealing with, then the result of what you're dealing with can't be detrimental to that relationship, really, because the relationship's more important. You're going to deal at that level. Once you do that, you see that the individual's development and performance is more important than all of those individual things. Now, obviously, if this is never going well, then the relationship's not going to go well. It's, it's two-way street here. But those are the two underlying principles. Okay, let's talk about adding coaching skills. So to me, leading is not managing. Craig and I have talked about this. You could have a whole podcast, a whole time and session we could just spend on that. But I think it's important to be said. Leadership and management, those are two different things. But leading is also not coaching. It's like the difference between directing and developing. And I like that analogy between directing and developing. So you coach to enable individual and teams to develop. I think you're going to coach three ways. You're going to coach technical skills. So if you're an accountant, you're going to coach how to be a better accountant, or better, maybe how better to provide accounting or financial advice based upon those accounting skills. Those are technical skills. Two, you're going to coach efficiency and effectiveness as a team and a team member. And that might be how the team works together. It might be, you know, and a lot of that is very important with how we make sure that teams are cohesive and then can interoperate with other teams or within the chains. And but the last thing is you're also going to coach people on individual leadership, on how they lead. And I saw something float up in the chat concerning followership. And I'm just going to make a plug. I am a huge proponent of the followership piece. The UK Army just came up with a new doctrine on followership, and I see followership as being a key skill towards leading. So, you know, but you're going to coach teams on those things. You have to foster a mentality that teaching and coaching is their way to advance. And ultimately, you're teaching and coaching to replace you as that leader. So as you as consultants, you might be looking at this saying, you know, but I'm not necessarily leading teams. A lot of times I'm put in as an individual, as I consult to try to enable this. But having that paradigm of what leaders need to be, I think is essential for you, because you're going to be advising within that realm. And then when you do lead teams, it's important to understand that you need to develop people. But there's a lot of comments that come back that I hear from, especially business leaders. I hear this in senior government as well. I don't have the time to be able to do this. I'm so focused. My thing is full with what I'm trying to do just to accomplish the vision and set that vision and set the conditions for success. I really don't have the time to teach that kind of stuff. And I don't have time to teach people that are going to replace me, that you're just going to have to develop their own the way that I was done, just thrown into it. I disagree. I disagree because what that does is it creates leaders, not by design, but by accident. And there's a difference between deliberately developing leaders, especially ones that can coach and develop their own teams, versus saying, I got thrown into that crucible and I developed just fine. Yeah, that's good for you, but it might not be good for the next person. And it's definitely not good for an organization point of view. The example I give is when I was in Haiti. I arrived in Haiti, and then down in the southern airport called Jacmel, where, you know, the governor general, which was Michel Jean at the time, was from, I had to put two similar organizations. They weren't similar. They're similar in size, but one was the airlift control element, which was operational control, and one was the mission support flight, which was all the support end of the organization. Then the two were of equal ranking, you know, commanders that were down on the ground. Very quickly, I had to be able to use tools to be able to look at these two majors, give them orders, give them the insights that they needed to be able to take on those roles. But for me, more importantly, I had to have a framework of tools, whether it's my personal example, the vision and intent, a vocabulary and a narrative and a connection, to be able to coach and mentor them. And even in the most critical and dire situations, 200,000 dead, people starving everywhere, and us having nowhere near the equipment that we needed to do our jobs. You know, I was running an entire airport with, you know, under 200 people, and that airport was extraordinarily large. You know, this is a real problem. Well, I was still mentoring and coaching those people because I knew that right at that instant, if I gave people the opportunity to step into my shoes a bit, to understand what they needed to step into, to make the space for themselves, that they were going to develop in so fast that there was going to be a baseline for solid leadership that would lead them into the rest of their careers. Now that's tough, right? Those framework tools have to be there, but it was based as well on an element of personal self-awareness as a base. So to all leaders, you know, I always say you have to have an element of self-awareness. You have to be ready to look back on how you led in certain instances and say, I did that well, I did not do that well, and be able to do that. And this leads to how, as an organization, we develop leaders systemically. So at an organizational level, so individual leaders need to take the time, they need to be a coach and mentor, but at the same time, at an organizational level, ask yourself the tough questions when you're looking at an organization. How's the organization deliberately creating leaders? So just throwing them into the situation, okay, How do you annotate where they're going to go? What skills they need? How do you watch them? How do you mentor them? Who's coaching them? Who's actually giving them the feedback, and how are you rewarding them? And there's a difference between trial and error exposure and success. And there's a difference between that and developing a real systemic approach to this. You know, when you're rewarding things, be careful of what behaviors are rewarding. It's one thing to say we're rewarding the people that are successful. Okay, but if it's only the people that are successful and not how they do their business and what behaviors that they take to enable that, then you're drifting from the values of your organization. And that's the last piece. You have to make sure that that's aligned with the example, the values that your organization has. For example, when I was in the Royal Canadian Air Force, I'm the guy who set up the baselines for all of the merit boards across the force so that in each occupation, pilots or navigators or whatever it was, they were set for how those merit boards were going to ascertain that which is performance versus that which is behaviors, you know, which points were, and then as well, which opportunities based upon that merit listing were going to be given to individuals, trying to take things like how do you balance character over qualifications. You know, these are the things that systemically you have to look at as organizations, and you as consultants can have a mirror on an organization to be able to look at. Okay, let's go on to the next slide and do something again a little bit more fun. Here's a question that I think is going to inform us as to how you think about the complexity of adding coaching to leadership skills. So once the poll's launched, you're going to have 30 seconds to input your answer. Okay, and there it goes. There's the poll. What's the toughest leadership role in any organization? Is it the first supervisor, middle management, or executive C-suite? So there we go. So that's the poll that's going, and it's going to be launched right now. And there's the results. Okay, wow. I this is very, very telling, I think, and I think you're spot on. Now, I personally believe that that first supervisor role is the crucial one. And here's why I differentiate that from middle management. And you'll stick with me on this. The vast majority of first supervisors that I see give me the same problem with respect to, you know, their first leadership or supervisory role. And that is they were thrust into it with little or no training, and they were told to add the management of their team on top of an already grueling, you know, portfolio that they had to manage. So it's the same element of work and lead a team. The reason why I say that I think that first supervisory role is more and is tougher is because if we set that team up for success, I think we'll find that the middle management role won't be as tough as everybody perceives it to be. For me, having solid example, being able to have been given the tools, especially in the military at that first level, to say, Scott, you're taking on these supervisory roles, and having great mentors that were able to be there and coach me through that, it made my middle management years much more easy to fathom. I still think that middle management is key. And I do think that executive leadership, once you set those first ones, this is almost the easy zone. You just have to make sure that you have the longevity to be able to go there. So there, that's what I think about those poll results. And that's really good. Thank you very much for participating. So let's go to the next slide and carry on, because the next thing I want to talk about is how to focus on individual development. So leaders, by focusing on the development of the team, but most importantly on the development of the individual, you're going to create cohesion as everybody sees their individual development tied to the success of the team, not only their individual performance. So I know it sounds backwards, but if you think about this, if my individual development is really tied to how the team succeeds and everybody's in that same mindset, I'm not trying to trump or be better than the next person. All I'm trying to do is develop so that I can enable the team. Now, what I've done as a leader by setting that up is intrinsically on the inside of each person. It's one thing to say, here's your individual goals. And I do think that leaders still need to take the vision, and visioning is an important thing as a leader, being able to break that down and translate that into the individual goals and provide that inspiration for the team. But arguably, the coach in every leader needs to translate what those individual tasks for an individual mean to them into something for their own development. So when you focus on that individual development, you're saying, hey, Craig, I know these are the tasks that I've given you. These are the things you have to execute over the course of the next 6 months. But what I really need you to do is I need you to be able to do this at the end, to taking on this role and then this piece. And these are the steps that are getting you to that. And the back and forth that happens with that connection that Craig and I will make. So yeah, but I might need some training on this. And I mean, okay, well, let's get you that to enable you this. But really, this is about your development. So the individual sees, yes, I still have to perform. Yes, I'm part of the team. My next translation to Craig's going to be, and you realize that this person here, and this person here, all part of the team. They rely on your outputs. They can't do their job. And neither can you unless they're doing theirs. And that's how that plays together as a team. This pulls the team together. Now, elevating that relationship above that daily performance, you're going to connect with the individual. By connecting with the person, you're going to understand what drives them at a personal level. Now, there's some people that are going to just say, look, you give me a paycheck, I work my hours, leave me alone. That's fine. But knowing and understanding that is essential to being able to access their motivation and how that plays out within the team dynamic. So you're going to inspire them by tapping into and aligning their values, their things that are important with them, with the values and the desires of the mission and the organization. But now let's get a little bit deeper into the how. Remember, I said communicate to connect. We're spending a lot of our energy with our teams within the confines of performance. I needed this report by this time. You have to be more efficient at doing this. It's all very managerial. It's all very transactional. It's all very, what I would say, binary. It's related to outputs, and we're not focused on what people think means the most to them. And I hear this a lot from whether it's business or government or military, everybody. People are disconnected from the mission. There's no employee loyalty. And funny enough, you talk to employees and they'll say, those leaders, they're disconnected from us. They, them. And when I was a general, I had to stop saying that because I was told, now that you're a general, you are they. So you're not allowed to get away with that anymore. But they don't understand me. They don't understand us. And they don't understand what we're going through to be, you know, to try to accomplish that mission. That disconnection has created people that really are just floating from one opportunity to the next. And they're not interested in the confrontation to be able to make that connection. By communicating to connect with teams and especially with individuals, you're going to have to deliberately schedule time formally and then informally. I said deliberately schedule time informally. It's like leadership by walking about. To know and understand the team and its individuals, you're going to have one-on-one meetings with your teams, and you're going to have group meetings that are not focused just merely on those outputs, but on them, the team, and the team's development. Finding time in those busy schedules to do that is essential to enable that team to develop, and it will connect them back to that mission because you're putting their care and their importance forefront in your agenda. So you remember I said, you know, communicate to connect. I'm going to say listen to understand. It's the next layer down in that communicate piece. And I think we all know that the one thing that most leaders do less well than anything else is listen well, because I think that's common across, you know, most high performing teams. Listening to understand means that you're not sitting there trying to just think of the next thing you are to say, that you're actually trying to take in what an individual's saying, understand their perspective, and either through, you know, repeating that back or putting it in a different context or contextualizing it yourself, then you're able to say, hey, okay, now I think I understand what you're saying. Now, using that understanding to connect with the team and the individual is going to connect them at an emotional level. And that's where we get back to this inspiration. And if it's an emotional trust relationship, you have to connect with them at that emotional level to the mission, to the vision, using their development to make that connection. Most of all, you communicate to establish trust. Their competence, their care, it's a reliability, means that you follow through on what you're going to say, and it's a sincerity. You say what you mean. So those things are are the basis of trust, and the four elements that I think there are trust, which is competence, care, reliability, and sincerity. The next thing is you're going to communicate to translate. Now, I like this because I think you're going to translate a couple of ways. You're not translating merely to repeat the vision, or even to explain their part in that vision, but rather how they develop in its execution. What's their path to advancement within the vision? Again, you're listening to understand, because you're going to have to communicate with them. It's not just you telling them that, hey, Craig, this is what your advancement is. Because you might come back and say, I'm not interested in that. That's not the path I'm on. I want to be here. Oh, Oh. And so there's going to be adjustments here. Might even be adjustments in the portfolios, adjustments in the team. I do this all the time with my complex teams. Translation connects them intrinsically with the mission, but it's going to result in adjustments perhaps to its execution, sometimes even to the narrative overall, depending on the team. But when we add effective and collaborative prioritization processes, even with detailed scheduling, this is inspired execution. So inspired execution to me is vision plus connection plus priorities plus scheduling. I'm going to put that in the chat because that's something you can take away. Inspired execution connects someone at an emotional level to that mission and vision. They see how it's going to program out, but they also see their programming of their development over time as well. That enables them to be really bought into the mission and vision. So at this point, because you're coaching the team at that group and individual level, inspiring them through not only the accomplishment of the mission, but their personal accomplishments in development, this is what I also call motivational mentoring. So let's go to the next slide. And this is the point where we're going to do our next giveaway. Let's take a second to ask the question that's going to decide this. Again, the winner is going to be decided in the minutes before our questions and answering, before the Q&A period, sorry. What are one or more of the fundamentals of stress mastery? So, you know, all of this leadership stuff, this takes time. I could see that you're going to be put in that corner, time and space. It's going to be tough. So what are the fundamentals, one or more, of stress mastery? How do you master the stress as a leader inside of that situation? All right, let's go on to the next slide. Now, one of the last things here that I want to walk through, you know, is giving trust to get trust. By investing in the team, the individuals, you're giving them your trust. Now, as a leader, I would often arrive in places. Haiti's a classic example, but even inside the NORAD team, my American counterparts at the outset didn't really know or understand me, and they didn't have necessarily any context on my military upbringing or my competence inside of those jobs. So I would automatically give 100% trust to my team, and then I knew that I had to develop that trust over time. By knowing my job or role as a leader, by knowing your job or role as a leader, and working hard to be the best at it, that doesn't mean you're going to be the best at it, but you're aspiring to be the best at it, to know and understand it. You're going to set an example, but also demonstrate your competence. Now, remember, there's four elements to trust: competence, care, reliability, and sincerity. And establishing that competence is important. Now, you know, I have these discussions with my sons all the time, who some of them are in senior, you know, executive management, and the best basketball player doesn't make the best leader on the team. That's for sure. But if you ever read Hal Moore, who's a retired lieutenant general from the United States and, you know, part of that famous movie, his books on leadership, he'll tell you that every single job that he got into, including going into those LZs in Vietnam, he studied hard, very, very, very hard to be, know, and understand. Now, there's another element to this. As you walk into a new job, if you're going to study hard, the first thing you're going to do is engage the experts that are there. By engaging them, you're already starting the establishment of that trust, that two-way street of trust. Now, next, by being reliable and sincere, saying what you mean, following through, and on both of those, like saying what you mean, sincerity, following through on what you mean, reliability, you're going to establish and maintain that trust. Now, for a lot of leaders, yeah, we're going to get after that. We're going to fix that. Sometimes you don't. Being accountable is essential to trust. So if I say to one of my team members, yeah, I'm going to get after that, I'm going to get you that opportunity, and I can't, I don't just let that go, nor do I blame someone else. It's my failure. I wasn't able to do that. I wasn't able to get that there. That's on me. That's what I mean. Too many times we push this off and we look at the organization wasn't ready to, and then you create a we, they thing. That's not going to establish trust anyways. You might be popular for a moment, but that's different than establishing trust. And accountability is essential to trust. So you need to have the individuals and the team enable that trust with you in order to receive theirs. So it's not an equal two-way street, and leaders don't need to stop looking at it as an equal two-way street. You're going to give 100% and you're always going to be working to develop theirs. You hold the team, but especially yourself, accountable for performance. Errors in performance aren't something that should necessarily mean that they don't trust you, you don't trust them, but you can't allow them to be anything more necessarily, at least individual errors, as a learning opportunity for the team. Now, this really depends on the nature of the air and this kind of stuff. But just because someone's not hitting performance goals doesn't necessarily mean, you know, that they're no good for the team and you have to move them on, or you're going to stop developing or whatever. Again, we're back to connect to the individual, set the positive learning culture that you want. Now, in that environment where you can create that trust, you're also going to create an element of creativity. By setting the trust relationship, you're going to provide psychological safety and culture so that you can be in an open, learning, and collaborative environment. So in the chat, we're going to put down what are my 6 tips for fostering creativity once this trust is set. That's for you as a leader, set the stage, be bold and inspirational. So whenever I'm going into a creative thing where I have the ability to widen the minds and I want the experts to kind of give me what it is, and I want them to be creative about it, whether that's how do we invade this country? How do we kick Hamas out of Gaza? But, you know, things like that. And yes, that those are the kind of plans that I had to execute. So just stay with me on that. Be big, bold, and inspirational. Right? Use keywords and a narrative and a vision that people understand. Use a lot of open-ended questions. Seek the team's collaboration as you're setting that guidance. That collaboration doesn't necessarily just have to be from inside the team. You can bring experts in from the outside. You can see that in the process of that creative process, that maybe there's a connected team that they need to be a part of this and engage them in this. Enable and devolve responsibility to a key member of the team. Maybe there's an informal leader there that is in that development process. Give them the ability to lead in that team and make sure that they know how you want to go about it, and stay close by so you can schedule updates with no specific agendas, and perhaps coach and mentor that person that you've devolved those responsibilities for. And then lastly, champion the success of your teams, especially in the creative environment. Any setbacks, these are learning opportunities, and responsibilities for setbacks rests with you as the leader. And the buck stops there, right? And that way, the team can feel safe and moving forward. When I was a young major, when I was a colonel, I had a young major in Haiti, one of those two that was down there on the airfield in Jacmel. I knew that this young major, because the other major was extraordinarily more senior, he was more seasoned in his leadership, and he had the operational support side. But, you know, on the back end of the organization, very young, very junior individual, I knew I had to coach and mentor him because he was not confident in his own skin to be able to do the things and get on. And what I did is I made sure I was present. I connected with him 2 ways, individually, but I also connected him to the mission. I made sure that he understood my mission and vision and intent, but I stopped short of telling him exactly how to go about it. I made sure that he trusted me and that he knew that I was never going to allow him to fail because I was going to be there to mentor him along. He started with always asking me questions because he wanted me to tell him how to get it done. Instead, I just spent time with him, told him what my vision was, repeated that, and told him, you know, try and get on with this. By unmasking my vulnerability and his, it shored up his confidence. He connected his inspiration to the mission. He took the inspiration of the operational mentor and liaison teams that we had in Afghanistan that were mentoring the Afghan National Army, and he took that model and created a team that was telling them how to do customs and border things, how to manage the bank accounts and future planning for the airfield. And when we left the airfield in Jacmel, you had a management team around that airfield that he had brought up that had a business plan for how they were going to develop that airfield over the long term. And I didn't tell him how to do any of that stuff. I just gave him a vision of leaving this airfield in a better state than when we found it. So let's go to the next slide. So we're up to book giveaways. And Craig, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Well, thank you, Scott. I've been going over a lot of the answers to the 2 questions that you put out. You know, your conversation and talk after those questions led to some of the answers. So people had to pay attention and listen. I don't think I'm an expert when it comes to knowing what the best or right answer is, but let's go back to the first question. And thank you, Scott, for providing some books that we will send out to these winners. We'll contact them to get to coordinate that. But the first question was essentially, what is the number one reason people would seek out professional coaching for? Right. And Jane Osler's answer was building trust with employees. So there probably were a lot of correct answers, but that's the one I selected as perhaps one of the main reasons people end up seeking out professional coaching or should be seeking it out. Can you elaborate on this a little bit for us, Scott?
So I think that establishing trust with employees, I think is fantastic. I think it's a great answer. If I was going to predispose this, and I kind of did before I came in here, I was thinking about what would be the number one thing. And I've spoken to an awful lot of professional coaches, compatriots and peers of mine. And what's so fascinating with this answer, which I think is the winning answer, obviously, is that it's not trust and establishing trust in other people. It's the fact that they don't trust themselves. It's the fact right. that they're lacking confidence in how they're doing things, that they're second guessing every single decision and piece that they're doing. They might be doing great things. They might be treating people. They might be developing fantastic teams, but they're really engaging coaches because they're not trusting that they're doing the right things. And especially at the top end of organizations, executive leaders, they don't have the same feedback mechanisms that a lot of other places do when you're wedged in the middle of a large organization. That's why I think that's a fantastic answer, Craig.
Well, and you and I had talked about this earlier, and you talked about the biggest transfer back to a mentee for a coach is really to help people to learn to trust themselves, right? And to get beyond the self-doubt.
We have this inner monologue, right? It's built upon a billion years of evolution that basically any kind of error could lead to you not being fed that day or dying in as a hunter-gatherer. Knowing that the psychological and chemical makeup of our brains is like that, this inner monologue that we have, and imposter syndrome is just a manifestation of that. You have to understand, it sounds so condescending when I say that, if people can understand that and put some distance between the emotions and thoughts that they're having and their behaviors and reactions to that. This is Susan David's work on emotional agility. The space between there can be choice. And by choosing the behavior, the reaction, then you can choose those behaviors and reactions that are more in line with your character. For me, I was a pretty brash and a bit tactless as a young officer because the job was to get the mission done and I wasn't interested in anybody who wasn't on my side with this. You have a CMC guy by the name of Mike Ennis that can attest very much to my rather brash and highly energetic style. Being able to put that space between there to choose the actions and behaviors that I wanted made sure that they were aligned with my true values and not just a reaction to a specific situation.
So the second question you had was name one or multiple fundamentals of stress mastery. Now, that seems to be really important, especially when you're in these military situations that you've described, in Haiti and Afghanistan. You're trying to teach leadership and teamwork under, situations where people could be shooting at you or people are dying all around you. So I had a difficult time going through some amazing, excellent answers or, suggestions for what the primary fundamental of stress mastery would be. I've selected Kyle Stamm and his answer, self-awareness, emotional fluency, and shifting from stress to pressure.
That's really good. I like Kyle's approach to that. I think that each person's going to have a different paradigm as they look at how to master their own stress. My pitch to the team, and you see in the chat, the things that I walk through that I kind of have as my approach to this. But I would also add, and I think Kyle speaks to this, there's a systemic thing involved here. Leaders are going to be in positions of pressure, positions of stress release, and knowing and understanding and being able to program that is important. And that's why the intentionality of scheduling, I think, was very specific for me to trying to manage stress of portfolios that were, well beyond. Like when I was at work at 6 o'clock in the morning, leaving at 9 o'clock at night, trying to manage a portfolio that was, in a single line, defend the continent. It's you know, it can be a little bit overwhelming, and being able to schedule and program that is important. But even more than that is, as a system and systemically, looking at how you manage the portfolios and lives of the people that are amongst you. It's not just an individual thing. You know, you have to manage your own stress, and then you walk away from that. Giving the tools and then monitoring that as a system and watching how leaders monitor that in their people will be very telling for leaders. I love Kyle's answer. That's great.
Can you extrapolate a little bit more on some of the other fundamentals of stress mastery?
Sure. So to me, it starts with the fundamentals of physicality. So first of all, you don't sleep, you're not going to work. I'm a helicopter pilot, so we were called to work on night vision goggles, or, you know, so we're flying basically around the clock at all times. So where you are in your circadian rhythm, how much sleep you're getting, the quality of that sleep, that's going to be number one. We were always, again, military guy, fit to fight. So I exercise hard daily. If I'm not fit physically, I cannot be fit mentally. And sleep and exercise are extraordinary. I'm not a guy that's going to tell you weight loss, this, that, and the other thing, but you have to eat and drink mindfully. You have to think about it and you have to enjoy that. That's not something that my wife calls me a scarf monster, right? Like literally something goes down on the table and the counter, and before she can walk around the counter to get it into the, you know, to sit down at the table, I've already inhaled and I'm on to the next thing. But sitting down and having a meal and being mindful about that is important. Developing self-awareness habits. This is, you know, to Kyle's point, journaling, meditating, reading, so that you are mindful about how to manage your stress. I recommend Arianna Huffington's book. She went through a very large burnout and has written very eloquently on that. I think it's very beneficial. Spend time on hobbies that are away from work. Think other things, whatever it is. Be able to clear your mind. There's an old Eastern adage that says, if your mind is so full with those things, the only way that you can actually get the creativity into your mindset is to, you know, clear the mind of those other thoughts. Hobbies can do that. Socializing, especially with your spouse and partner over time, these are going to be essential. And then this goes back to Kyle's point, deliberately programming space. I walked into meetings knowing how I wanted to be in meetings. I programmed time for preparing for those things, and I was very mindful. And then when my schedule got filled up, I started to make hard choices of things I was not going to do. When I was a colonel in NORAD headquarters, my schedule was programmed from 6 o'clock in the morning until literally 6 o'clock at night, every day, 7 days a week. And I was running a command center, 5 crews that were watching the world. There were no days off. We were watching the world all the time. So for 3 years, that can be an overwhelming tempo of operations. I started not doing things. I didn't go to meetings. And there was generals that got very upset at me. And I said, sir, can't do this, can't do this. These are the priorities. And they were hard priorities. They're gut-wrenching. Just do it. Because once you do it, you'll be able to be more effective at that which you do execute.
So some of the folks have mentioned in these in the answer to that question, you know, being positive with your, having a positive outcome vision and holding the vision and maintaining the course. I suspect that, how do you fit that? Where does that fit into all the other sort of stress mastery elements that you just talked about?
So I think it's
the beginning, the end, the middle.
No, I think it's an interesting conversation to have. So let's start with, I led the pleasured life of always having a purpose and a vision that, quite honestly, I could define for myself within the larger context of serve my country. I always knew that there was a mission that was going to be associated with me, you know, going into harm's way, being a leader of people that could be making catastrophic decisions for, you know, life and limb, and that could have very large consequences for the nation. So for me, I didn't have to always worry about that vision. And I always had better leaders. I say always, maybe not always, but most of the time, better leaders above me that were setting out clear vision for me. So when I laid out my elements of stress mastery, they're always based upon the fact that I'm going to set my vision for myself. But I like that. If I go to James Buttner's book on and his research on the blue zones, that which is creating longevity in people worldwide, a sense of purpose and connection to community are two of the major things. It's not just diet. It's not just climate. It's not just all those things that we think are creating longevity in people, but a sense of purpose is key to being able to do that. So I think that's a great answer. I never really thought about that, but I think the reason why I didn't is I've always had it as part of my life. Even now I'm retired, I want to give back. And that sense of always being of service to me is my own sense of purpose. But I think you're right. I think there's an element of having that personal vision and purpose, not an organizational one necessarily, because I came to a large schism when I left the service. And I just decided that there was a different way that I could serve. I hope that answers that for you, Craig.
Well, yeah. And you've put it in a larger context of a larger vision, not just the vision of the project at hand, but a vision of how to handle yourself in many life situations, right? And in that way, as a coach, you're also setting by example. It must be difficult at times, and maybe you can expand a little bit on, I mean, how do you coach or teach self-awareness in leadership? What you're talking about, creating an emotional connection here to gain some trust. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that, maybe some examples of that.
For sure. So first thing about self-awareness is, if people aren't looking back and reflecting on the situations and interactions that they have with the people on their teams or around their teams, with their superiors, with other people that they interact with within their network, then that's the first thing. And when I say reflective on, it's not like, hey, I was in the shower this morning, I was thinking about that conversation with Bob. Okay, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about being deliberately reflective on. And to me, that manifests itself as journaling, which means write that down. Right. How did that go? How did you not? If you're not going to think about those things with the purpose of being a better leader, then the answer is you're back to this. Oh, yeah, I'll just react to the situation and the situational form. Okay, you're not being reflective about this, because the reality is, if you're not going to be reflective about this, you're not going to be able to see the delta between where you are and perhaps the new behaviors and skills that you have to apply. Back to Kyle's point about being intentional and programming things, I think that is, there's a direct tie. There's times when I've come out of meetings, gone on my journaling the next day or that night, and I'm saying, you know what? I wish I had been more like, okay, 2 days later, I'm back into that same team. But a day later, I'm setting the intentions for that meeting the next day. So in my, you know, I have my journal, but I also have my book that I'm working in, or it could be whatever else you use, or the read aheads for that meeting. I'll set, right, I want to be more like this. I want to be remembered, think like this. And I'm changing, I'm adjusting my style, I'm being reflective. And so in my coaching, I bring together those elements, saying, how are you doing this? How are you making that change? So it's pragmatic. It's not just, oh, I want to, right? So and there's a difference between want to and willing to, right? I want to be better. Okay. What are you doing about that in terms of pragmatic actions? And if the answer is not much, and that's what you see out of a lot of leaders. Yeah, I want to get better. There's a lot of words there, but not necessarily the actions to change those behaviors. Then they are willing to allow that, whatever that is, to perpetuate. Those are the kind of two things that I tie together.
But are you helping people find maybe and understand where their weaknesses are, so that they can be aware of those and then be better leaders by knowing how their strengths and weaknesses can allow them to emotionally build a team where there's an emotional connection between all the team members?
So absolutely. And there's a couple of things here that I would put together. So professional coaches, and I have a love-hate relationship with a lot of professional coaches, because I'm of the belief that if we have leaders inside of organizations that are coaching their teams better, then the need for, you know, executive coaches that are just sitting on the outside trying to enable this piece diminishes, you know, quite a bit. And, you know, they can be cost prohibitive, to be clear. Not everybody's going to be able to engage a coach at, like, I don't know, $500 an hour or whatever it is. So I think you're bang on track here. What you want, if I was an executive coach on the outside, I'm going to use the Socratic approach. I'm going to ask a lot of questions to try and get after, what are those things that are preventing you from, what is the emotional underpinnings here that are trying to build this out? But I see that as being an expertise in the coach. And if you need that, you're going to go there. For leaders, You have to be present. And here's the problem space with a lot of leaders. A lot of leaders, when they're looking at their subordinate leaders or their teams, they're not watching them in action. This is tougher in today's world with remote work, with all the rest of the stuff. But getting a sense to how people are leading. I commanded an air wing of the Royal Canadian Air Force that was seven helicopter squadrons. Those seven squadrons went from, you know, Edmonton, Alberta to Gagetown, New Brunswick, all over. And then, you know, Iraq and places like. So I spent 270 days a year on the road because I needed to be out with those leaders, not just talking to them. I talked significantly to them, but I talked to the people they were working for, the people they were supporting. And I talked a lot to the people who were down inside their organizations to see how these leaders were leading. And then I would hold that up as a mirror to those leaders. You're doing a great job. This is a performance like this. You're treating people poorly. This is not going well for you. How are you changing this? I don't want necessarily the performance to change, but I would allow a slide in performance if you actually, you know what I mean? Like there's a 1, 2, 3 here that you're getting after. And by being present, you're able to coach them because again, it becomes about their development. My analogy to this is I used to go into the field or go into these places and I would be over the shoulder. So I'd watch these leaders leading their squadrons and that, and I'd be, hey, have you thought about this? Think about this. How did you approach that new leader there? Is that person working out? I think they're a little bit, maybe they're in the long role. Okay, let's talk to this other person. This might help. By doing that over the shoulder, they don't feel, hey, I'm not threatened by this. I need to know how you're going to lead. So if I send you over the horizon into combat, you know, thousands of miles away, I need to trust that you're going to be able to do this in an effective fashion. And the right way. So I hope that answers your question.
Well, it does. In many ways, it answers it. But it also says to me that you're recommending a style of coaching where when you're with some of these executives or high level, military people or anyone high level in an organization, that you're going to kind of shadow them a little bit.
You have to. I think you have to. I think that I used to say, if I'm not spending 20% of my time preparing the people on my team to replace me, then I'm not spending enough time. And to think I had a portfolio for the Royal Canadian Air Force that was, it's easier to explain what I didn't do. I didn't buy things. So other than buying things, everything else in the Royal Canadian Air Force walked through, you know, my office as a one star. So the real answer here is that if you have to spend the time to develop those people in that role, and I'd give people the opportunity, and don't just give them the opportunity when you leave. So in large organizations, I'm taking vacation for the next 2 weeks. Sandra is now taking over for that thing. She'll be in that. Okay, that's an opportunity for sure. But if it's only when you depart, what message are you sending and what opportunity do you have to actually mentor? Craig's going to be my acting for the next week. I'm going to be doing this thing and focusing on this one thing. Craig has all the authorities and all the rest of stuff. I'm not going anywhere, but my sole purpose, I won't answer questions. I will defer everything to Craig. He's got all my authorities. My sole purpose in the next 2 weeks is to mentor along Craig because if it's no secret, he's the next guy that's going to replace me and he's going to be able to do that. And I can see how Craig's going to act in this and I can watch all these things and I can be there and I can mentor. There's a presence here. That leading by example, which is one of my premises of leadership, my command philosophy, you know, it has to shine through and it allows for a deeper connection with the people that you're leading.
Now we've got about 5-6 minutes left. So if anybody has any questions for Scott, type them into the chat. I'll keep my eyes on it. I've got lots more here that I would love to talk to you about and ask you about. I'd like to talk about NORAD for a moment. Okay, you spent quite a bit of time in NORAD. A friend of mine who I met through the CMC organization was in NORAD himself for several years. And I think during the Cold War, he talked about Russian airplanes that would push the airspace and some of the situations that he had to deal with mitigate the situation, make sure it didn't blow up into something some pretty hairy stories that he told me about in NORAD. And you're working with Canadians and Americans. There's got to be a real sort of leadership style difference between those two forces and those two nations. Can you give us some examples of that and maybe things that you had to deal with on in that regard?
So for sure, there's definitely a cultural difference between the Canadian and the American militaries. First of all, and please don't take this as any slight against Canada, the Canadian national emotion surrounding the military and military service and things that are happening internationally is apathy. We see it on the news. Oh, that's bad. And then we go right back to whatever it is our daily work is. And that is not the approach that Americans take with that. Military service in Canada doesn't have the reverence that it has inside of US culture. Now, that being said, I think as well, we're a little bit more balanced. I don't think that just because someone puts up their hand to serve in the military is a rationale for me to beast them for the next 35 years of their lives and own them and just give them orders willy-nilly without understanding that this is an individual that I want to take care of and I want to be in for the long term. The US military is extraordinarily large. And the vast majority of people do not move up the ranks to the top level. They also have a management philosophy that's called up or out, which means that you have to hit gates for advancement in rank or progression. And if you don't hit those gates, you're given a letter and you leave the service. So there's an extraordinarily competitive flow that they move up to the top. So they're always getting better. They get better, and it's based almost primarily on performance, and they're given larger and larger and larger responsibilities to be able to do that. So leading inside of those two environments is the same thing with putting together all sorts of other eclectic teams that we'd see between. I've served in many domestic operations, whether it's the ice storms, the Winnipeg floods, forest firefighting, all of it. You go into these situations, and us in the military, we're never leading, right? We're never in charge. We're leading from behind. We're trying to enable someone else. So I was always taught, walk into this team, provide exactly what you can. And what we'd see from a lot of the leaders in there is they had given these responsibilities, but they didn't know how to lead these eclectic teams. And I would just advise, yeah, I think you should do this. And maybe if you gave that to the team, maybe if you told everybody what that was about, that'd be okay, good, good, good. And this is kind of a little bit with the Americans. The Americans are also, especially the American military, they favor a certain dynamic personality, as in their leadership styles. So, you tend to demonstrate that, or at least I had the ability to connect with that, so that there was times when I had to demonstrate strength. I had to demonstrate strength. Now, to be clear, what you're talking about there with Russia, that was going on. The 2 years that I was in Alaska, I saw unprecedented Russian military aviation right alongside the Canadian and American borders. And if it was happening off the coast of Halifax and Baltimore, we'd already be at war with Russia. These people are preparing to attack North America, and they will do it without notice on whenever, President Putin sees fit. So be able to lead in those environments is also about, I know our adversaries are watching everything that I said. So when I was giving news, or if I was on social media or whatever else, demonstrating strength in the mission and the, is extraordinarily important because everybody's watching everything that you do. So in those environments, you have to be able to access strength, but you have to be able to show balance, and you have to be able to understand the different cultural dynamics that are at play. Those are
It's kind of
important.
like we're heading into another Cold War. It seems to me like what's going on in NORAD today is more important than ever before, with respect to, watching what's going on with our airspace and our digital space, if I
Very
can
much
put
so.
it that way. What about Haiti and Port-au-Prince? You had a pretty grueling experience there. That's another hot spot where there's been talk of Canada getting involved again and helping out. Should we be doing that? Is that something that can be that where there's the wind down there? Is it possible?
Well, that's a bit of a loaded question. Okay, so Haiti. There's a few facts that surround Haiti that most Canadians aren't necessarily aware of. Port-au-Prince, main center point to Haiti, a city that was built with the infrastructure for about 400,000 people. There's 4 million people living in this city. There's no subterranean architecture in Port-au-Prince. Translate that, there are no sewers. Everything that goes is on the surface. That's problematic from a cholera and health point of view. And then your building materials are just garbage. So what that means is every time there's an earthquake, everything comes down around your ears. So building of infrastructure and everything else Now, the second part to this is that there's very little middle class here. There's an extreme poverty, and then there's people that control extreme wealth, and they can inoculate themselves to all of the elements that now you have gangs that are out here and around that are controlling, whether it's the port or the access to electricity, water, food, whatever it is. For governance inside of Haiti, you're going to have to set up institutions, and those institutions are going to have to be strong. In Haiti, that's not the case. Business leaders and senior government officials are extraordinarily corrupt, and it has been the case. The one institution that back through the 90s was really, really struggling, and even up to 2010 was really struggling, was the PNH. It's the Police Nationale d'Haïti, or the Haitian National Police. It is the one institution that has proven itself at least somewhat effective at staving off many of the elements of corruption within the city, within the country, and being able to have some sort of effectiveness. This is where the UN is focused. That's why the Kenyans have been asked to come in and do this. Now, whether the Kenyans will be any more professional, because corruption even within their own police services is interesting. However, the Kenyan police force has an element to their force in terms of their structure that is more like a gendarme, more like the Italian Carabinieri, which is a paramilitary force. So they will be able to quell the kind of violence that a normal UN police force would not be able to do. I think that there's some hope there. Now, from a Canadian point of view, should Canada be involved in this? You know, I think that somebody needs to be involved in this. But back in the day, you know, there was even push in 2010 to say that if the Haitians can't manage Port-au-Prince after the earthquake with all of the aid that was given them, then why should we be trusting the Haitians to just about anything? And so the reality then is, should the UN take over and manage itself? Now you get into elements of national sovereignty. But by the way, the same conversation was had in 92 concerning Sarajevo. Should, you know, the UN just come in and just all of the authorities go it and will manage this city, country, whatever it is, until it can have the stabilities of a nation state. The UN does no more have the structures, especially concerning corruption worldwide and things like this, to be able to effectively manage governance over that place. So should Canada be involved? Yes. The Canadian military is in no position, none, to be able to do this. It's not a priority. I'm sorry. It's hard to say. We're back into this, you know, global conflict versus helping the third world. The third world's going to be what the third world's going to be, and we need to stave off, you know, future aggression from Russia. And Ukraine is on the front lines of fighting this right now, and it's just a matter of time. People ask me, you know, what do we think about Russia? And I say, well, we should be preparing for the coming war with Russia, because it's just a question of time. And that's my perspective, and that's based upon what I know, based upon my previous jobs.
Well, thank you, Scott, for joining us today. Some fantastic insight on coaching and developing leaders. And I like that you're staying involved as a retired military person and sharing your experience. And I think making your expertise available to people going forward is wonderful for them and encouraging for all of us. You know, my takeaway is you want to develop leaders. Yeah, we need to develop them, and we need to teach them how to create trust and get people connected emotionally in achieving the excellence that need to be achieved, and to create that framework for excellence, which helps, I think, you know, manage the stress of implementing it. That's kind of my kind of wrap up on today's conversation. Thanks again for joining us, Scott. Everybody sign up, register for What's Up Wednesday next month, November 8th. We'll be talking about artificial intelligence and data analysis. Have a great month of October, everyone. Cheers.